how is a bhikkhu moderating eating? While reflecting rationally, he eats food neither for the sake of entertainment, nor of infatuation, nor wishing for bodily beauty, but exclusively for the support and maintenance of this body, for ending discomfort, and for assisting this noble life, considering, thus will I now end this old feeling of hunger, yet without arousing any new feeling of greed. Thus will I remain healthy, blameless, and in comfort, exactly as one treats an open wound, only for the purpose of healing it, or as one greases an axle only for the sake of easy transport of a heavy load. So does a bhikkhu, who is moderated in eating while always reflecting rationally, eat food. Thank you.
Yes, hello to you, friends. We are again back in the jungle, in the wet jungle, to make a small guided meditation on a old school subject, namely gratitude, katanyo in Bali. But first, the normal intro. Namo Tassu Bhagavato Arahato Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the best Buddha. The Buddha typically pointed out four persons one should be grateful towards. And the first of them is one's parents. And this can be a big issue because there can be conflicts and various degrees of friendship and harmony between all beings. And this also goes between children and their parents. But it's very important to have gratitude towards your parents. Why so? Because they are the cause that you are existing, basically. And this entails that if one disparages or is aggressive towards or in conflict with or in disharmony with one's parents, then one usually induces self-hate because one is against one's own cause, basically, namely the parents. And this is often unseen. And usually during the teenage years, one will have eventually has to do with leaving the nest. Then one has to stand on one's own legs and find one's own legs first. And then usually one is a revolutionary and has some kind of opposition towards the parents and their opinions about what is right and wrong in life. Usually there will be a disharmony between the daughter and the mother and the son and the father. And this then can last years on and maybe never be got repaired. But one should look at it as a bump on the road. Well, there are bumps on all roads, in all friendships, in all human relations. There will be these bumps on the road. But one should not regard them as more than that. Then one can come over the bump and then look back at one's parents with gratitude. And that's very, very important. Otherwise, one will never come to like one's own existence because one dislikes or is opposed to one's cause or causes, namely one's two parents. I read up what the Buddha said about it because he was very emphatic about it and put very large emphasis on it. The next one is one should be grateful towards one's teachers because they go through a lot to make one learn what is good. Both teachers in the school, one's parents as teachers, other family members as teachers, once the teachers one has professionally on one's job or university, school, high school, professional school, whatever, where one is taught, one should be grateful for that. Because it is quality that is coming into the mind, understanding, and thereby future enjoyment and absence of suffering. This of course goes in particular, I would say, to one's Buddhist teachers. Because why? Because they teach one deathlessness and the release from suffering. And nobody else can do that. And they do it for free, out of their own good heart. And this one should show gratitude towards. If one doesn't show gratitude towards one's teachers and parents, then it's kind of like perverse. It goes against nature because they are giving one free service, free gifts that are long-lasting. Basically, all one's joys in life is caused by one's parents, by having them putting one into existence and introducing one into the world. And when in the other end of the scale, when one leaves the world, leaves samsara, and achieve lasting happiness, complete peace, and absolute freedom, the deathlessness of Nibbāna, then it's because of the many Buddhist teachers one has had through all this life where one has been in contact with Buddhism. This doesn't need to only be monks, can also be lay people, can be anyone, actually. So one should be grateful towards whatever is giving of information. Like one should be grateful and service. One should be grateful towards whatever is giving of material goods. When one reaches this gratitude, this state of gratitude, then you can see on my face, the smile starts spontaneously. It's a very warm, good feeling. Then one is thankful and show gratitude towards those who have given one. This comes to mind that every time I make food in the morning, monks are not allowed to make food, but unfortunately I have to make food. Then I think about the people who have donated this food. Month after month, there are a small band of four or five who give regularly. And there's particularly one person who gives every month. And I'm very grateful for that, that he actually feeds the monk and the cat and the dog, time in and time out. And he will never regret that. And I'm very grateful for it. This gratefulness, this gratitude is gracious in the sense that it makes mind feel worthy and honorable. And lack of gratitude, it goes the other way around. It makes mind feel pity, small, disgusting, ugly, because it goes against nature. It goes against nature. It goes against harmony. The third one should be grateful towards is one's friends, because they have shown one much goodwill by being one's friends and helped one selflessly over a number of years. And then one should be grateful towards one's spouse or lover or partner, because they also endure one's own mistakes, and they have shown one a lot of goodwill, accompanied one along a curly road. So they have been with one in good times, and they have been with one in bad times. So first of all, parents, teachers, in particular Buddhist teachers. Third, friends, spouses, partners. These are the four. What are the karmic effect of being having gratitude? This is actually that one keeps getting gifts and services and offers. People will give to one who have shown past gratitude. So the probability for getting more in the future, whether services or information or Buddhist training or whatever for free, it goes up with gratitude. What about gratefulness goes down? So the ungrateful person, they get less and less and less and less and less. Of course, huh? Nobody will give to one who don't say thanks. Huh? How poor it is not to be able to say thanks, thank you for a gift. It's even embedded in normal politeness. I think in all cultures, that you should say thank you when somebody gives you a gift. Thank you. So one should put a lot of effort on that. So this gratitude, this gratefulness, this gracious gratefulness, it pays back but should not, of course, do it. One should do it altruistically, but should just know that this is the case. This is the case. People will give more and more. One come into better circumstances. Being grateful, being ungrateful, one will not receive anything whatsoever. Neither teachings, nor materials, nor opportunities, nor jobs, nor anything. Nada. So remember that. Usually, gratitude and gratefulness is seen on with is being slightly underestimated, the power of it, and also the efficacy, the extremely detrimental efficacy of ungratefulness or lack of gratitude, because this is going down. You lose all opportunities. Nobody will give you anything. Gracious is gratitude. A small citation, the Buddha once pointed out, gratitude is an important mental quality. These two people are hard to find in the world. Which two? The one who's first to give a kindness. And the one who's grateful and thankful for any kindness done. Anguttara Nikaya 2:18. So, two persons are difficult to find in the world. They're rare and precious. It's those who come when asked, or when somebody is needed, whether help or funds or medicine or teachings, they are the first to give. The first one, on the spot, their miserliness has been reduced to pure zero. And then the other one, who's also very rare, but also very beautiful, good Kalyanamittas, beautiful friends with beautiful minds. This son who are grateful, who are the first to say thanks. You have hardly given them the gift, then they thank you. Hardly have given them the gift. And this connection, I feel a lot of richness when I see that these videos and these audios, there are more and more people. I get, on average, I would say 5 people every day that say thank you, Bende. And this, I think, is this gives me something back for this significant effort that is done. And it also gives them something. And knowing it, that it gives them a better opportunities in the future to be grateful, this also makes me more happy. Because then I know it works. It's a positive feedback loop that makes both parties, both the monastic Sangha and the lay disciples, devotees, go upwards to higher degrees of freedom, higher beauty, higher strength, higher intelligence, higher level of rebirth destination. The Buddha on this parents issue, because I get a lot of letters about people having problems with their parents, and I also had my own problems with my parents. They are over now, but nevertheless, there was problems. And this, I think, is very common. So the Buddha on relation to the ideal relationship with a Buddhist disciple and his parents. I tell you, monks, there are two people who are not easy to repay. Which two? Your mother and father. Even if you were to carry your mother on one shoulder and your father on the other shoulder for 100 years, and were to look after them by anointing, massaging, bathing, and rubbing their limbs, and they were to defecate and urinate you right there on your shoulders, you would not thereby repay your parents. Even if you were to establish your mother and father in absolute serenity over this great earth, abounding in the 7 treasures, you would not by that repay your parents. If you make them emperor over the entire planet, you still don't repay them. Why is that so? Mothers and fathers do much for their children. They care for them. They nourish them for long. And they introduce them to this world. But anyone who arouses his unbelieving mother and father and settles and establishes them in faith in the 3 jewels, the Buddha, the Dhamma, and the Sangha, arouses his immoral mother and father and establishes them in virtue and morality in the 5 precepts. Anyone who arouses his stingy mother and father and settles and establishes them in generosity, Arusus is unwise mother and father and settle and establish them on a new level of true understanding. It is in this way that one truly repays one's mother, father, many long-standing services and sacrifices. Anguttara Nikaya 2.32, Book of Tools, huh? Mother and father. So what he says is, you can take up your mother and father and carry them around on your shoulders while they urinate or defecate on you for 100 years. You can make them emperor over the entire planet. Still, you have done repay them. This one should think about, huh? Because usually the services one do repay one's parents with is less than that. However, if one, which is difficult, establishes one's mother and father in understanding of the Four Noble Truths, making them have faith in the Buddha, Dhamma, Sangha, making them take up the five precepts, or establish them in generosity, then one repays one's mother and father. Why is that so? Because if one can do that, very difficult, but not impossible, then this will better their prognosis on the very long run. Very long run. This may spare them for 10,000s of death or 100 billions of death, because they come closer to Nibbana. There's many stories about the Buddha in his former life where his son became a Buddha, Pachika Buddha. And he was not a Buddhist himself at that time, he was Hindu. But then he will go and search out for his son, didn't find him. But then heard he had been a Pachika Buddha and he died and there was built a stupa for him. And then he searched his stupa for his son and carried around lights all night long around this stupa. So the son thereby establishes his father in respect for the Buddha Dhamma Sangha even after his own death, by what he have done and by his imprints in other people's reports to the father who is seeking his son somewhere in India. Parents, he also said, compassionate to their family are called Brahma, first teachers, those who are worthy of gifts from their children. So the wise ones should respect, honor them with food and drink, clothing and bedding, anointing and bathing, washing their feet. Performing these services to their parents, the wise are praised right here, and after death they rejoice in the divine world. Itibutaka 106. As you see, to a larger extent here in the East, that people pay respects to their parents. I've seen in a family that when the father is going out, then the two children will bow down and kneel down all the way to the floor before he went out. Then they go went critically through his dress, whether he was probably dressed. And then when they were sure that the father was probably dressed and everything was in order, then they sent him away. Two teenage children. That's the way. If this is what you think of me, the Blessed One is sympathetic, is seeking our well-being, teaches us the Dhamma out of sympathy, then you should train yourself in being in harmony, cordial, without any conflict, and train yourself in cultivation of these 37 fine mental qualities. So if we should repay the Buddha, who have gone through immense number of universal cycles, for our sake, then we should train these 37 producers of enlightenment, the Bodhi Pakhiya Dhamma, the four foundations of awareness, Chatusaripatthana, the four right efforts, the four ways to success, the five abilities, Indriya, the five powers, Bala, seven links to awakening, culminating in the Noble Eightfold Way. Is from Majjhima Nikaya number 103. Tathagata is worshipped, honored, respected, thanked, and shown gratitude by any follower who keeps practicing the Dhamma in accordance with this true Dhamma, who keeps practicing masterfully, who lives in and by this Dhamma. Dikka Nikaya number 16. And this is true. The further you come down the road of the Noble Eightfold Way, the more gratitude, because it works. It works. It's not a bluff. It's not a cliche. It's not banal, it's subtle, but it's effective. And when this purity sets in, this happiness sets in, this bliss sets in, then you of course become more and more grateful towards the one who opened, who cleared this path for you, and for free showed you this path. And even though he did it 2,500 years ago, still we can sit about it and talk about it here in the forest. Still he's sitting, being free, me and you, among others. Still. So we should be enormously grateful for that. Thank you, Buddha Gautama. And thank you to all the other Buddhas in the past. And thank you to all the Buddhas who will come, who are Bodhisattvas right now. We will undertake and practice those qualities that makes one a contemplative, so that all those who helped us by services of robes, amphoras, lodging, transport and medicines will bring them great fruit and great future reward. Majjhima Nikaya 39. So this one thinks a lot about this. I think a lot about as a monk, and this is something that you carry around on your shoulders, because technically speaking, when I receive something from the lay people, and there are many people who give me something now, I'm recording on a small Sony camera, a fairly expensive actually, that has been given to me by lay people. And so my obligation, my duty then, is then to purify myself to the largest extent I can, because then the karmic ego will be enhanced for them. That's a very large unlinearity about the ego. If you give to a dog, you get it back 1,000 times. If you give to a thief, you get it back 1,000,000 times. If you give to a layman who is not a thief, who also gives, then it's 1,000,000 times 1,000,000, it's 1,000,000,000,000 times. If you give it to a stream enterer, then if you say it's incalculable, incalculable, asankhya, cannot be calculated. It's not infinite, but it's coming approach that you cannot calculate it. If you give it to a Samasam Buddha, then it's incalculable to the seventh degree. You take infinite or incalculable and multiply with incalculable and multiply with incalculable 7 times. This will then last many universal cycles. So the echo, the probability echo, depends upon, I think, the magnitude of the consciousness, which is dependent upon the purity and the nobility of this particular stream of consciousness. So it's a wave phenomena, and this wave phenomena has a specific frequency. This doesn't change, but the amplitude changes. And as this is what I think it is, it's not yet proven scientifically, but I think that this consciousness wave, the orthogonal wave system that goes back and forth in the other direction, just like electromagnetic radiation is a wave in two planes, as a electric wave undulation, and then there's a magnetic wave undulation, and this then can travel through empty space because there's two waves. So also I think there's two waves, one consciousness wave and one probability wave, that also can travel through empty space. And they can have different amplitudes. And this may entail that if your consciousness amplitude is very high, then the probability amplitude is also very wide, they have a large amplitude. This means the echo that people do good to a noble, they get a extraordinary reward. Still, if you give to a thief, there is a reward, there is an effect. But we can say it's an underestimation to say it's 1,000,000,000 times, 1,000,000,000 times, 1,000,000,000 times, 1,000,000,000 times smaller than if you give to a noble. So there's an extreme non-linearity in the effect of giving. The Buddha said about give to those you feel happy to give to, those who need it and those who are worthy of it. And the last class is where you really get the karmic bingo, the lift, huh? Giving a lotus to the Buddha, and that's why we are doing these offerings, and I will do that one in the future also for a person in New York whose uncle just has died of esophageal cancer, very nasty disease, very bad prognosis. It's as nasty as it comes, actually. The karmic lift for that is extraordinary, extraordinary, even after the death of the Buddha. The imprint is still there. The echo wall is still there. Just a note about the word katanyu in Pali for gratitude. Actually, literally means it's what has a sense for what people have done for one in the past. Not only in this life, but also in prior life. So remembering all help, all his parents was as have, and all his friends wanted to have, and teachers wanted to have, through this immense, this network of kindness that has brought one forward, lifted one up, like on a plate. This one should remember. This is gratitude, and this is very gracious, very gracious. So thank you for seeing this video and telling about it to your friends and those you think who are worth listening to. I can say as a standard practice I do myself when I do either metta, universal friendliness, karuna, infinite compassion, mudita, infinite mutual joy, or upekka, parami, and brahmavihara, equanimity, meditation, then I say standard to all four directions. Actually, it becomes six directions because there's also above and below. Then I say thank you for all the help. Whoever is out there, infinite in space and infinite back in time, in these six directions, thank you. And then I rejoice that they have been, since they have been helping me and others also, then they have been lifted karmically. They have gained elevation, karmic elevation, instead of karmic crash. And then I say sorry for all my mistakes. All things I did wrong or bad or not ideally, or all omissions, all good, the good I missed to do, not supported those who taught me and supported me, and not showing gratitude to those who supported me or brought me into being. For example, my parents. I say sorry for that. So all transgressions, all mistakes, all omissions, and all delays where one have done what one should do, one's duty, but one did it too late. This I say sorry for. But first I start with thank you. as again, gratitude is gracious, graceful. What do I mean by graceful? I mean it's a very subtle, elegant, eloquent, harmonious, beautiful quality. Beautiful quality. Gratitude. Thank you. Namo. Tassu. Bhagavato. Arahato. Samma Sambuddhassa. Worthy. Honorable and perfectly self-enlightened was the Blessed Buddha. Thank you to all supporters, especially the regular supporters, monthly supporters, those who give food and those who support the meditation hall. Thank you. May much merit be all yours, and have a nice and noble day.
Nagas Mountain. Driving home through the bushland. Driving home through samsara. Many obstructions. Here, there. Everywhere. Obstructions. But one should never give up anyway. Just keep striving. Making progress day by day, minute by minute, second by second, one breath and calm is there. When calm is there, there's also peace. When peace is there, inner peace, then there's also happiness, bliss, one breath. Thank you. You heard Bhikkhu Samahita from the Cypress Hermitage on the Knuckles Mountain, Pamparela, Central Hill Country, Sri Lanka. Please subscribe to the Google group Buddha Direct and visit the website whatbuddhasaid.net. May all beings become thus happy thereby. Thank you. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. Worthy, honorable, and perfectly self-enlightened was the blessed Buddha. Thank you for your contribution, and have a nice day.